This is Matthew Ostrovsky, bringing you the first of a series of tutorials for the Mubu family of objects developed here at EARCOM. This package is a set of objects designed to work with the Mubu multibuffer object, with the goal of taking different kinds of data, such as a sound file or gesture capture data, together with analysis data for that file and synchronizing them into one data structure. The Mubu package also contains a number of processing and analysis units for audio and data, collectively known as PIPO, which stands for Plug In, Plug Out, designed specifically to work with the Mubu architecture. Mubu is particularly useful for such applications as granular, additive and concatenative synthesis, machine learning, and gesture recognition, and much more, which we will be exploring in later tutorials. Before we get to the fun stuff, however, let's start with some basics. First of all, you would like to install Mubu, which you can find in the package manager. Just do a search for Mubu. There it is. My copy is obviously already installed, but you can start off by installing your copy, and then we will be ready to go. So a Mubu object is instantiated, of course, like any other Max object. You simply create it. And it takes one argument, which is simply a name. This works exactly the way the name of a table or a call object does. All Mubu objects with the same name will share their data. You can look inside by double-clicking on it. As you see at the moment, there is nothing in there. But like tables and calls, Mubu files can be read to or written from disk. So let's take a look at that now. Mubu editor. So now, as you can see, we've got some content inside this track, and we'll be looking into the guts of that a little more in a minute. So how is a Mubu structured, and what makes it different from other kinds of Max data structures? If we take a look here, we can see this blue box here is a Mubu, and each Mubu container can hold an arbitrary number of what are called buffers. Now, these should not be confused with what we normally think of as a max buffer, which is normally just used for audio data. But in Mubu, a buffer is in itself a container for other kinds of data. If we take a quick look again in the editor window here, we can see from this one tab at the bottom that this Mubu only contains a single buffer. Each buffer is in turn comprised of an arbitrary number of tracks. And tracks are where sound files, analysis data, and any other kind of data that's relevant to your project are actually stored. So we can think of a buffer as a container of tracks, which is actually your guts of data. And then the Mubu itself is a container of containers. Now, one important thing to know is that in a Mubu, every buffer will have an identical track structure. So if you add a track to one buffer, that track will then be added to all of the buffers in the Mubu. Normally, the way tracks work is that each track will contain a different description of the same temporal object, such as, for example, in this case, in the first track here called audio, we have a sound file. And then here in the second track, we have a set of descriptors for that sound file, or something like velocity and position data from a motion capture would also be another possibility. What we're looking at now is an iMubu, which, similar to the iTable object, is simply a Mubu with a user interface that is always visible, like a table. A Mubu can take a refer message, so we are now pointing this iMubu to this Mubu over here. So that iMubu and the other Mubu are containing the same data. let's have a look at this in a little more detail. As I mentioned, this contains one buffer, as we can see from the bottom tab, and two tracks, one holding a sound file and the other holding analysis data for that file. Along the top of the editor window, you can see we have a time display. You can adjust that display by click dragging up and down. More or less like that, should you want to. And here on the y-axis, we have the range ruler, which will adjust depending on the scaling of the kind of data that you're putting in. As you can see here, where we're dealing with amplitudes, we've got a negative 1-to-1 range. And over here, we're looking at frequency bands. The bottom of the editor window, we have a number of different options for viewing, selecting, and manipulating the track contents. At the moment, the audio, we're looking at the audio track, and we're looking at it in wave view. You can tell the selected view because it's a slightly lighter color than the other buttons. And the male track, we are looking at in sonogram view. And we'll cover these views in more details as the occasion arises. But to get a sort of clearer idea of exactly how the tracks are organized and what kind of content is in them, we're going to have a look at them in matrix view, which shows the actual data contained in the tracks. Now, in most editor views, just important thing to note, time goes from left to right. However, when we're looking in the matrix view, time goes from top to bottom. So let's make a note of that. So what we're seeing here actually is the index number of each sample in that file, plus, of course, its amplitude value in the column marked scalar. So looking at the MEL track, also in matrix view, what we can see is in this case, each index, again, index has not one, but 24 pieces of data, one for the amplitude of each one of the 24 bands of the analysis. And just for fun, I'm just going to show you here. This is another MUBU containing accelerometer data from my phone, which we are looking at in multi-wave view, in which each column of data gets its own wave. I mean, for that matter, we could even look at this MEL track in a multi-wave view as well, but perhaps it's not quite as useful. So let's take a closer look into the structure of the track itself. So this is a little schematic of a MUBU track. And just to make things a little more consistent, let's just look at this audio track in matrix view for a moment. So each row in the track, get some numbers here, each row in the track, which in MUBU we call a frame, holds the data for one point in time. And each one of those frames, as I mentioned, has an index. Now, time in a MUBU track can either be regularly sampled, as it is here, at, not surprisingly, the audio rate of 44.1 kilohertz, or it can also be time tagged, which is usually used for breakpoint functions. And we'll take a look at the time tags a little bit later. It's also important to note that different tracks can sample their data at different sample rates, but we'll go into that in a little more detail in a second. So each frame has an index, an optional time tag, as I said, and the data for the frame is held here in what's called a matrix. Because although, in this audio track, for example, each frame is holding only one piece of data, it is possible to store an arbitrarily sized two-dimensional data matrix in each frame. We can see, for example, here, let's look at these descriptors. That's similar to our MEL analysis. Each frame contains a whole bunch of data. In addition to that, each frame can hold an optional text label, which most often gets used in tandem with time-tagged frames or markers. And finally, in addition to that, outside of the entire time structure of the frame, each track can hold a dictionary, which can contain sort of any arbitrary set of key-value pairs. It's often used to store such information as the GUI state of the track, but you can put anything you like in there. Let's take a quick look at, if you go to the info button, that will show you, just as an example, the dictionary data for the track. So these descriptors, interface multiwave, color mode rainbow. If we look at the audio track in the dictionary, we have all kinds of stuff, file path, markers, identifiers, and so on. Let's just get back to the matrix mode here for a moment. So how does all this work in practice? So let's take a look at these four tracks. And we've already seen how this works in an audio track. Each frame holds one datum, and it's at a sample rate of 44,100 hertz. So let's do a quick count here. Okay, we've got about 125,000 samples. So let's keep that in mind. So let's look at the descriptors again. So that's actually this track with all these little brightly colored lines on it. Let's look at it in matrix mode. And here we have a 9-column, 1-row matrix stored in each frame, in which each number represents the state of one of the descriptors at a certain moment in time. So let's have a look at the number of frames in this track. All right, this one has about 960 some odd. So what this means is, since we're referring to the same chunk of time that is fit in the audio, is that this track was sampled at a rate of about 350 milliseconds. Because, of course, in the case of analysis data, it's neither practical nor especially useful to record analysis data at the audio sample rate. However, when this buffer is actually played through, all tracks will be correctly aligned in time, regardless of the sample rate. So let's take a look at this track marked Transp, which is an arbitrary name. This is a breakpoint function. If we take a look at this, let's have a look at the time tags here. So this is a time tag track. And as you see, for each frame, we have a time value and a value associated with each one of those. Similarly, here's another time tag track called markers. And this, again, let's look at this in matrix view. This has, again, our time values, arbitrary data, which is in the matrix, and these also have labels. Going back to its original view, which is marker view, we can see how each one of these markers has a label appearing on it. Let's all put all this together. Let's get out of matrix view on everything so it feels a little more organic. Breakpoint function, descriptors, multiwave, audio wave. All right. Isn't that pretty? Just to sort of give you an example of how all the tracks are aligned in a buffer, I'm not going to go into the weeds quite yet about how the data is accessed, but we'll be covering that next. And of course, you can always have a look at these patches as well. Firstly, I'm going to iMubu and I'm going to set the cursor tool. And this now gives me a cursor. I can drag around with my mouse. which, as you see here, will output the position of the cursor in the MooBoo. So, just for example here, let's turn on the DSP and see what we get. All right. So, let's go through these various outputs one at a time. First of all, you can hear we're doing a little bit of granular resynthesis on this file. I'm going to kill the volume on that. And here in this outlet, we're simply getting the sample values interpolated between frames in a 0-to-1 scale. This is the contents of the descriptors track, also interpolated. And as I'm sure you could hear, I'm transposing our old friend the Cherokee sound file using the values derived from this track called transposition. And finally, you can see how in the last outlet over here, we're getting the marker label outputs as we are crossing them. Next, let's take a look at creating buffers and tracks, adding data sort of by hand, and accessing that data. Most of the time, you're likely to be filling your tracks with data generated by MooBoo's analysis modules rather than inserting it by hand. But doing this gives you sort of a nice clear examples of exactly what's going on under the hood. So here we have a brand new iMooBoo. It initializes, you'll see, with one buffer and no tracks in it. So let's start off by adding an audio track. The read message will read in an audio file, and the @name attribute will either send the audio to your track with that name, if it exists, or if there is no track with that name, it will create a new one with that name. So if we look at this, we've created a track called audio. But if I send this read message to the same track, then it'll simply replace that. The read append message, however, will always create a new buffer and load the audio into the named track. So here with read append, you can see I'm creating a new buffer. We now have two buffers. And you can also create a buffer with the add buffer message. And you'll see that the third buffer also has a track with the name audio along with it. So now if we sent a read message with the name attribute of that track, so if I send this here, because this is the current buffer, I will load that file into that buffer. So whatever is the currently selected buffer in the bottom tab, if you send a read message, that is where it will go. The clear track message will clear the contents of the track in the currently selected buffer. So clear track one clears the contents of track one. And the, or it will also do it with a named. You can use either the name or the number of it. So if we go here and say clear track audio, there you go. It's gone. And then I can just reload in there. Now the remove track message will remove the track from all buffers. So if I remove track one, now that track is totally gone, although the buffers remain. So let's just get some more data back in here, shall we? Not too surprisingly, the clear message will remove the contents of the tracks, but you'll notice it still leaves the buffers in place, and the clear all message takes us right back to the beginning, removing all tracks and all buffers. So let's take a look about reading tracks with other kinds of data. This is normally done through the add track message to the Mubu. And I'll say it again, adding a track will add it to all buffers in the Mubu. So let's just stick in another buffer to prove my point. Add buffer and add a track, and it's in both of those tracks. But let's take a look at the add track message. The add track message needs three arguments. The first one is its maximum size in frames, the number of columns inside the data matrix, and the number of rows. There are a number of additional attributes that can be added as well, but we're going to start off with name, which I recommend you generally use when creating new tracks. It just sort of keeps your head a little more clear. So if we add this track as we have and look at the matrix view, we see that it's simply empty because we have not actually put any data in it yet. Also, you'll notice that setting the maximum size does not actually create empty slots. It's simply reserving memory for the entire track. Now let's stick some data in there. The easiest way to do that is using the track message, which is sort of all-purpose track control command. So we're going to start off with the message track, and then again we would put either a name or a number here. We're going to shoot a 1 in there in a second, and append, followed by a list. So let's toss that in there and see what happens. So it simply sticks data in there until the message runs out. So if I send that message again, for example, you will now see I've simply added that 1 to 12 list a second time. Let's send that same message to a track with a different matrix size. So we're going to create a new track here, which we're going to call data in columns. Here we have a maximum size of 1,000 frames. And here, the first argument, which is columns, is going to be 3. And you'll also notice I've added a couple of GUI attributes here. At info, and that's basically something that gets tossed into the dictionary for the track. GUI, interface matrix, and added the attribute matrix call names, X, Y, and Z. There are a million GUI options for this object. You should definitely have a look at the help file later on. And so now let's send this exact same message to this track. And you can see that now it's simply rolling it out per frame. So now, instead of the 12 frames we had when we sent the message to the single cell track, now each frame is getting 3 pieces of data. So track 1 has 12 frames, but this one has only 4. Now, just to keep things fun, we're going to do it, but here we have 1 column and 3 rows. Take a look at that. Add that data. Now, this looks identical, aside from the fact that I named the columns. And this doesn't make much of a difference now. And usually, if you're doing something that's simply got one multiple dimension on it, you put your data in columns. But it will get relevant later on, and I'm just sort of showing it to you now for completeness' sake. Let's add one more track here, and this one, we're going to have 2 rows and 3 columns in each frame. So let's take a look at this, stick that data in there. And now we have a slightly different kind of display here. we only have two rows, frames, which makes sense because each one of these holds six pieces of data. And if we double click on this, we can see, again, it's simply spooling out column and row. And you can close that there. Now, every time we go to one of these frames, every time we go to one of these frames, we're going to get out that entire matrix of data. Now, let me clear the decks here. And now we're going to take a look at how you make a time tag track. Now, a time tag uses the same basic format as the add track message. Right, like that. Size, columns, rows. But we're adding the attribute time tagged one. As usual, I'm naming it, putting in some info things in there. Autobounds will simply set our range once we put some data in it. The autobounds message actually gets sent to the Mubu itself, not to the track. There it is, our new thing. Now let's add some data to that. Now in this case, here we go. We're going to send it pairs, and that's only a pair because it's only expecting one datum per each frame. And the pairs are time, value, time, value, time, value, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So if we go look at this in the matrix, you see these line up with that. The sharp-eyed amongst you may have noticed that this append message was not attached to the Mubu, but rather to this object called Mubu Track. This is a very handy object for both setting and accessing values in a track. It takes two arguments, the first one being the name of the Mubu it wants to talk to, and a track number or name. And you can change the track you're addressing with the Mubu Track object by sending it a track ID message, followed again by a track number or name. Now, the Mubu Track object will not actually create a track, but once a track has been created, you can both set data to it and access data from it. And in fact, unlike a lot of other Max objects like table or call, where you would normally send your queries, your data queries directly to the object, in Mubu, the way one normally gets data out of a Mubu or an iMubu is through the Mubu Track object. So let's make another one here. Oop, there's another one. Now this one you will notice we're putting in three columns of data. And I'm just going to switch to matrix view before we put the data in. And now, again, same approach, append. But now for each time value, I'm going to send it three pieces of data. Oopsie, have to change the track ID. So I send it to the right place. And there it is. So again, we have time and then three values for each. Normally, something like this, we could also view in the multi-BPF mode. So we can see right here, we have the three sets of data. So, which again, we will get when we access this. So another useful thing to know is that you can actually use the Mubu editor window or an iMubu to edit values directly from inside. So if we go into draw mode over here, we can drag points around as we see fit. You'll notice if you move one, they will all go because you're basically moving the time frame wherever you want. If you command click, you can add a point. And again, move them around. You can move them, they're constrained to where they're last put, but you can add as many points as you want. Move each column individually, obviously. And not too surprisingly, if you want to delete a point, you can do it with the delete key. And all that's really happening when we're doing that, right, is we're simply adding frames or changing the values inside the matrix. Now that we have sort of some sense of how we get data into a track, let's talk about how we actually get it out again. Unlike most max data structures where you would query the data directly from the object, in MooBoo, we do use the MooBoo track object. So here it is. Here are arguments. Name and initial track, which again, we can change with the track ID. And also, if you are dealing with the MooBoo, which has multiple buffers in it, which is pretty common, you can change the buffer you're addressing by using the buffer index message followed by the buffer number. The most basic thing one would use is the get message. And what the get message does is simply take a frame. Let's see. Let's point to track number one and just start getting some frames. So what we're getting here is, let's look at that, matrix view. We're getting the contents of that frame, which is both our time value and our scalar value. And these values are not interpolated. Actually, let me add an audio track here. And that's going to be track number three. And it basically works the same way with audio data. We're simply taking the frame numbers of the audio and getting them out. If we use a second argument with the get message, we can actually get a bunch of frames. So this, the first argument, is going to be our frame index. And our second argument is going to be the number of frames we want to get. So this is going to give us the contents of frames number 56 and 57. Let me make my life easier and do something like that. Get number 5 and 6. And there they are. And you can do this with any arbitrarily sized chunk, should you need it. What we're most likely to be using for a lot of this stuff, however, is the sample message. Now this, you are no longer working with time in frames, but with time in milliseconds. And it is going to interpolate between values. So in this case, we just slide up here. And again, we're simply looking at the audio track here. So we're just getting the audio amplitude values, but it's a little clearer. Let's look at this BPF2, track ID 2. And we sample through this. And you will see that it is outputting the contents of each column and interpolating between those values as we go in time. Oh, by the way, worth noting that if we, let's make a new track with a matrix in it. And that is track 4. Let's put some data in there. And let's see what happens when we get this out. Let's just send a get message to frame 1. And you will see that it outputs the contents of that frame as a list. So it's important to know that it doesn't maintain any kind of matrix form when you access it with a get message. That is enough for today. It is very important that you take a look at the help files for the MooBoo object, full of fun facts, far more details that can possibly be covered in a tutorial. Also, likewise for the iMooBoo object, all kinds of groovy stuff you can do with that. And also, for a kind of deeper understanding of how all this goes, worth looking at the help file for the Mubu track object as well. Next time, we're going to talk about actually doing something with this. Hopefully, we can get some sound out of everything. And thanks very much for listening, and see you soon.